St. Stephen's Cathedral in Vienna is considered to be one of the most important Catholic cathedrals in Europe. No wonder that in this 16th century map of the city, which is kept in the main historic museum in Vienna today, the cathedral is depicted as the very center of the city. But if we pay close attention to the image, we will see that on the top of this Christian cathedral stands, very well visible, so-called Islamic symbol. According to this Scaliger version of history, the Ottomans sieged Vienna a few times but never managed to really conquer it.
Now let's look at another medieval engraving where the actual siege of Vienna is depicted.
And surprise, surprise, on the flags of the attacking so-called Muslims, we see Christian cross, and not one, but a few of them, along with the Muslim crescent symbol. This very crescent symbol that used to stand on the top of the cathedral for centuries is now carefully kept in the museum of this very same cathedral. All other artifacts have proper description and very detailed information is available for about almost anything else, including full history of the tiling of the floors, while obscure, unimportant artifacts were exhibited at prominent places. The very emblem of their cathedral used to stand in the most obscure, dark corner without any inscription even for a long time. It looked very awkward. On one side, the history books tell people that Vienna was never taken by any Ottomans, and yet for a long time their most important Christian cathedral had the Muslim site on the top of it. Some 10-15 years ago, when the project of the new chronology started getting popular, people heard about this, and when they were visiting this museum in Vienna, they started asking, what is this? How come this the symbol of the enemy on the top of your most important cathedral? Since the public was asking more and more often, the management of the museum started coming up with the various explanations. Various stupid explanation labels started appearing. This is one of them. Somebody took a photo of the actual museum tag that the Kaiser and the King are the stars and the moon and everything is just an innocent symbol. What symbol of the Mother, Father, the Moon and the Kaiser? Suleiman, that's what it's written on the artifact itself. Maybe the story with the Kaiser on the moon and the Father on the Sun or whatever didn't work very well because people reported few other equally silly explanations put on tags over there in the museum. Apparently they changed them as people start laughing. And they will continue coming up with new and new joke stories forever until there are people to believe them. And such blind believers seem to be plentiful still. Most of the people accept for a pure coin what they read in the official textbooks of history, which indoctrinate people to believe that people were always fighting, blinded by religious fanatism. People mostly believe in these fairy tales of violence instead of believing the artifacts which show that in those faraway times, these two religions, or actually maybe they were just two divisions, two branches of the same faith, they coexisted absolutely peacefully. Hundreds of artifacts are here to testify, to prove what I just told you.
And the main symbols of these religions are not so religious in the way we are accustomed to think about it. Actually, they were inherited from the previous beliefs before that, and they were always symbols of those who are on the side of the goodness, the pious and modest people, as opposed to those who vow to the forces of the dark.
Most of the attributes of the Russian tsars, kings, and emperors have Arabic inscriptions on them. It's also all over their thrones and other belongings.
This doesn't look good for those who preach the modern mainstream history. That's why when they had to take photos, for example, for school books, they would always take them from an angle from which such inscriptions would not be clearly visible.
When the team of the new chronology started raising the question of these Arabic writings, lie was quickly coined in a desperate attempt to find some sort of explanation. The lie was that since the Russians did not have knowledge how to make their own weapons, they had them ordered in other locations like Saudi Arabia, Turkey and many others. How could Saudi Arabia, that did not have any mining at all developed or any factories, big scale factories to manufacture such things, supply the full Russian army? Moreover, such explanations contradict other historic records because in various countries in Asia there are gifts of similar weapons that the rulers have received from the Russians. At that time, the industry in Russia was well developed. There was a lot of mining and a lot of factories manufacturing such sophisticated items. Moreover, on these weapons that are supposedly made in Islamic countries, there are plenty of depictions of human figures, and this is just one of the many examples of so-called Islamic helmets that are full of figures of people and animals.
Such depictions are not allowed in Islam.
Russia, the Christian country, was manufacturing items with Arabic inscriptions, and not only weapons. Some luxury items that were definitely made in Russia also have Arabic inscriptions. And side by side with these quotes from the Quran, in some cases, there are purely Christian writings. The official explanation of Cyrillic writing right next to the Arabic is that the weaponry was received as gift from the Muslims, but then the Christians added their own next to it. However, the team of the new chronology debunked this lie as well with the fact that in some cases the Russian Cyrillic writing was cast in such a way that it was obviously present at the time the weapon was originally made and could not have been added at a later stage. And I mean, all this explanation that even the kings were wearing Arabic inscriptions, considering them as elements of flowers without understanding them, is quite stupid. If Christians and Muslims were really bitter enemies, as the followers of Scaliger are trying to convince us, then I personally simply cannot believe it that the king would wear inscriptions on the Quran on his own head, right on the forehead. And what were the Ottomans doing at the same time? I would like to read to you what a 19th century German, mainstream German historians write. Although they are trying to find some sort of awkward explanation to these facts within the scope of the Scaliger version, still the very facts that they present are very interesting.
Islamic rulers belonging to the dynasty of Dashimed of Cappadocia
minting coins depicting Jesus Christ. Some of them had the special Christian Gigliati cross, the one you can see on the screen. It seems, continue the historians, that they were just imitating the coins of the European kings that you see now on the screen, without understanding the meaning of these images.
The quote continues.
It seems other rulers of Asia Minor didn't want to be left behind. That is why they were also minting coins on which these fanatic Muslim rulers depicted themselves with European crowns on their heads, with European daggers and decorating themselves with Christian cross. All this must have been done by the inexperienced workers in the mints, who did not understand what are they depicting because they didn't know Latin.
So what's going on here? Christians with Muslim symbols, Muslims with Christian symbols?
I think the answer is that the history suggested by the New Chronology Project corresponds much better to the historic artifacts, and that means that there was one single culture in which Christianity and Islam were coexisting absolutely peacefully, and they were in a peaceful symbiosis, so to say. Artificial separation and religious fanatism were instituted later on by the fraudulent history with the only purpose to divide and conquer. The plan was to gradually make the genuine spiritual culture of the survivors to rot from inside, and then with the help of mass media to gradually introduce the parasitic culture and values and make them look natural for humans, which is not the case. The real humans do not belong to this movie of horrors that is now artificially imposed upon them. Both Christian and Muslim symbols were official emblems of the Empire of the Survivors and were used all over its territory. Here I want to give another actually very hilarious example of how the believers of Scaliger tried to explain uncomfortable artifacts. German royal regalia or insignia are the accessories and outfits which a German emperor or king would usually wear during coronation and other special occasions as signs of his royal power. And in a rare 19th century Germany history books, we find a very curious depictions of some of these outfits. The mantle of the German king has Arabic inscriptions on it. Any German writing is nowhere to be seen. But even more interesting, I find the official explanation of this amazing fact. This mantle must have been obtained by Friedrich II when he took possessions of the treasures of Henry VI. Well, the very word must have been already points to the fact that this is pure fantasy. Follow the story further. And since at this time the regalia of the German kings was damaged, they decided to use the mantle that was already in their possession in their treasury.
Let's follow their fantasy, yes. An old mantle can be damaged. That happens in life.
After that, nobody in the entire kingdom or empire could get this brilliant innovative idea to make a new mantle with their own German symbols?
Or maybe there were super smart people who thought of making a new mantle, but there wasn't enough funds in the entire empire to manufacture a new one, and the situation was so bad that even the emperor had to wear second-hand clothes of unknown tribes. By the way, the very same book mentions that in the regalia there was the sword of the king. They didn't want to even make a sketch of it. There was only a brief mention that it looks very ancient. And needless to say, any of these items is not available in any public museum exhibition. The museum vaults are of course tightly locked on the pretext of keeping the items safe. And in our century of advanced technology, imaging and recording and everything you say on the phone, you write on an email is recorded forever, there is no way to get digital images of the vaults, of the content of the vaults of the museums, and we have to feel lucky that this sketch of the mantle survived in the old German book.
Charles the Great, great Christian king, Wikipedia assures us that he campaigned against the people to his east, Christianizing them upon penalty of death, at times leading to events such as the massacre of Verden. His mantle, his ceremonial outfit, is now kept in the Aachen Cathedral treasury. This fanatic Christian wore the signs of Islam all over his mantle, and he had the main Islamic sign right on his chest. People were not those religious fanatics that we are led to believe they were. We have been misled to believe that they were fanatics with the purpose that we become fanatics and start killing innocent people for no reason whatsoever. Catholic Cathedral of St. Vitus in Prague, we are being assured that this is purely Catholic cathedral, yet on a central place we see Orthodox writings. These Italian and German swords are kept in a museum in Toronto. The Arabic inscriptions on them are uncomfortable for the official history. That is why they fabricated a clever description and put it even besides the swords in the museum. The explanation is that at some later stage, the swords must have been kept in some Arabic storage place, and that's why, for the purpose of inventory, these Arabic inscriptions were placed on them. Well, it is written in a museum on the wall, and people actually believe these things, stating there is some research behind it. However, the proof of this story is absolutely none. And most likely these old German and Italian swords bear Arabic inscriptions because at that time they were part of this big, vast culture of the survivors, which was using Arabic language as one of the main all over its vast territory in which Germany and Italy were parts.
This is a Viking ring kept in the Swedish History Museum. One day somebody decided to take a close look at it and discovered an Arabic writing mentioning Allah.
Countless number of churches have the symbol of the crescent, the purely Muslim symbol of crescent, on their crosses. It seems that in the not-so-far-away past, Christians and Muslims could exist peacefully, but since they adopted the new history, conflicts started appearing. A very interesting piece of literature has fortunately survived the medieval cleanup of books containing real history, and that is Voyage Beyond Three Seas, written by Afanasy Nikitin. The book is written in Russian, well, most of it. The interesting thing is that right in the middle of the Russian text, the author elegantly inserts full passages in Arabic. Moreover, they continue to be written with Russian letters. One example. O my Lord Jesus Christ, please be merciful upon the sinner Afanasy Nikitin. After a few more sentences in this spirit, he says, O my Lord, Allah, my guiding star, Allah, Karim Allah, Regim Allah, Karim Allah, Regi Melio, Allahim Dulimo. And after that, he goes on in purely what we would call Christian spirit. And since he was writing this book to be read by the audience, not for himself, obviously the normal people at that time found it absolutely natural to switch between Russian and Arabic at any given time. Later in the book, we can even read Issa Ruholo.
In translation, that would mean something like Issa, the Spirit of Allah. Issa is the name of Jesus Christ.
At this point, we need actually to coin a new word. Is this a Christo-Islamic prayer or Islamo-Christian? And this is not the only book of this kind. Similar passages are found in a number of very old Orthodox prayer books. Günter Lühling was a German scholar who specialized in Islamic studies. He learned perfect Arabic and spent a long time in Syria for his studies. The conclusion of his research is that initially the Quran
evolved from what he calls Islamo-Christian songs.
Paul of Aleppo was a Christian monk who was accompanying the Orthodox Christian patriarch Makarios III Zaim in his travels. The book is called The Travels of Makarios. So the question arises, in what language was this book written? The supporters of this Caligari theory, of course, will reply that this Orthodox Christian monk who was traveling with his Orthodox Christian father and staying in an Orthodox Christian country, Russia, would write his book in Russian or maybe also in Old Greek language. Or maybe, in the worst case scenario, it would be in Latin. However, the book is written in Arabic. And not only that, but inside this book, he writes actually in Russian language, but written with Arabic letters. To avoid this uncomfortable situation, modern historians declared that Paul must have been of Arabic origin, without any proof, of course. And even if we assume that he was born in an Arabic environment, still his book
puts a very valid and big question mark next to the approach of the modern historians, who automatically put an equation mark between anything written in Arabic and Islam. That is a widespread practice, and it has been adopted as if it is self-evidently valid, although it does not have any proof at all.
And now, this is an original 17th century mantle of an Orthodox Russian priest kept in the Uglich National State Museum.
All inscriptions on it are written only in Russian and only with Slavic letters. The inscriptions are fully readable, and there is a clear mention
of the Holy Cross and the Holy Resurrection. However, the very top row, in absolutely clear and well-preserved Slavic letters, it is written Allah, Allah. I hope it is becoming clear, all those lies that the Arabic inscriptions on the helmets of the kings were just flowery elements and the kings had no idea what kind of decoration they were. No. Geberstein, a German ambassador, visited Russia a few centuries ago, and this is an authentic illustration that he published for his journey at the time it happened.
Just have a look what kind of outfit is the Russian king wearing. We would classify now this as purely Muslim, but this is not the reality. This style of clothing was adopted all over the territory, which was influenced by the culture of the survivors.
This is the symbol of the town Halle in Germany. It is a traditional symbol, of course, that is still in use. However, it looks too Muslim, and that is why a new explanation has been fabricated without any basis, of course, that this actually is a symbol of salt. Yes, salt, pepper, oranges, bananas, everything else except the truth. Ebla is an archaeological site in Syria. The famous clay tablets were found there. And in the beginning, when an Italian translator started working on them, everything seemed as usual. However, When the translations were published, it became clear that they are changing the history as we know it. One of the things that was mentioned by the translator, that actually the history of all religions together is different. The translator was personally threatened and forced to even renounce his existing translations and to stop translating further. In 2013, during the war in Syria, the place where the tablets and the research papers on them are kept was bombed and destroyed. This is an actual footage of the situation after this bombing.
The forces of evil were not satisfied with merely sending events back in the historic timeline.
They also embarked on the task of presenting the local governors and rulers of the various provinces of the Empire of the Survivors as independent rulers to cover up the traces of the survivors. Second, they created tons of fictionally phantom events and persons to fill up the artificially manufactured gap of the 1000 years shift back in history, and also the other shifts. That was a lot of vacant space and time in history that needed to be filled up with something artificial. That was not difficult to achieve because in various areas the people had different names for the same person. For example, Charles is in French, but the same person in England will be called Charles. And yet, if we go to Spain, the same person would be Carlos. In this way, the same person would be reflected in the history of various nations under a different name, and the events that he is involved with will be similar, however not exactly the same. Many such phantom events or doubles of the same have been discovered and studied
by the historians who are contributing to the new chronology project that evolved around the work of Anatoly Fomenko.
The next task of the fabricators of the history was to ascribe the knowledge and culture that the survivors brought to various uncivilized nations and tribes as local. They always try to assure us that the tribes naturally evolved and learned, discovered how to do things just like that by themselves. The next task of the fabricators was to misrepresent the various groups of survivors and always provide some sort of explanation that these were actually local people or they came from somewhere else, but that they were not actually what they were and things like that.
Twisting the original pure spiritual knowledge spread by the survivors
was vital for the parasites. On one side, they absolutely had to deprive the humans of their true spiritual path so that they can render them powerless as they forget their true nature of magical interdimensional beings. And the parasites managed to put most of us in very tiny boxes of existence and convince us that this is all that is. There is nothing outside of this small box and you live inside it. On the other side, the new parasitic colored versions of religions became very, very convenient in starting wars. And wars are favorites for the parasites. Not only the humans kill each other without any external help, but also it gives pleasure to the parasites because that is exactly their very nature. It is one of suffering and misery and pain. As far as Christianity is concerned, there is almost no point discussing it. So much has been written, and so many people have expressed their legitimate concerns that in its most popular form nowadays, It has very little to do with the mission of Christ or his person. There is plenty of evidence and historic artifacts pointing towards the fact that Christianity, Islam, and in fact all world religions have a common source.
The Vedas, the religious scriptures of India, underwent relatively much less parasitic addition than the other scriptures around the world. Some minor changes could have been made in them during the times of the couple of language reforms when people were forced, the Brahmins were forced to rewrite their books in a new language. Although such reforms could have made some points blurry, like for example the count of the years, still the main message made it through.
And as far as Buddhism, Buddha himself was born and raised within the environment of Vedic culture. So in one sense, Buddhism is kind of a branch of what we call Hinduism.
But sadly, not all Hindus today understand this true message that came to them through the centuries.
The reason for this is the heavy pollution on their consciousness on the side of the modern culture. For example, this is a set of desktop items. Most of us, when we look at them, we either understand very quickly what they mean, or we can find out quickly and easily learn what they mean. But to a member of an uncontacted tribe from the Amazon jungle, these pictures will mean
either nothing or something completely different than the meaning in the context of the IT technology that we understand so easily.
In the same way, most modern Hindus will keep at home books containing valuable knowledge, but will understand very little of it because they have lost touch with the culture that used the ideas on the basis of which this knowledge is presented. For those who are genuine seekers, I want to recommend this website as a real, genuine place to find out more about the real ideas of Sanatana Dharma, Buddhism, and Yoga.